This presentation will provide an overview of the porphyrias, which are a group of disorders related to abnormal hemoglobin synthesis. Learning objectives. The goals of this presentation are to understand, first, the biochemical basis for porphyria, as well as appreciate the main subtypes of porphyria is divided by clinical presentations with correlates to biochemical phenotypes. Thirdly, we will attempt a basic understanding of the basis for the laboratory diagnosis of porphyria. And finally, number four, we will understand potential treatments and prevention strategies of porphyric attacks. This talk will briefly describe the porphyrias, which are eight diseases that are all closely related to the biochemical level but have diverse clinical presentations. We will discuss hemoglobin synthesis as the biochemical basis for the generation of toxic metabolites which cause porphyria. This will lead to an overview of the separate forms of porphyria. Diagnostic testing and treatments for and prevention of porphyria will also be discussed. The key to understanding the porphyrias is understanding that the buildup of toxic byproducts related to disordered heme synthesis explains the spectrum of clinical symptoms seen in these diseases. All tissues in the body synthesize heme as it is used in diverse processes in the body such as oxidation and mitochondria, and it is also found in hemoglobin and other macromolecules such as myoglobin. Most of the heme synthesis occurs in the bone marrow, but the liver is another major site of production. Errors in heme synthesis in the liver account for overproduction of metabolites which cause acute intermittent porphyria. The majorities of these disorders occur because of germline mutations in the enzymatic processes of heme synthesis, although some cases, such as cases of porphyria cutanea tarda, can be acquired. Symptoms of these disorders then occur because of toxic metabolites which build up as intermediates in the heme pathway due to deficient enzymatic processing. The metabolites specific to each enzymatic defect and accordingly to each subtype of porphyria dictate an individual clinical phenotype. Broadly, the porphyrias can be divided into those causing neurologic attacks, those with cutaneous symptoms, and those where both of these symptoms overlap. This is the biochemical pathway that results in heme synthesis, and this is highly regulated within the cell. Heme is shuttled away to cellular processes after production in the mitochondria. In this graphic, for each step, the enzyme is listed at the top, the gene encoding the enzyme just below this, and the respective disease caused by individual abnormalities at each step is below in a red box. The key regulatory step of heme synthesis is the first step where glycine and succinyl-CoA are condensed to form ALA. This is tightly regulated by heme, which provides negative feedback, and other metabolic processes also provide feedback at this step as well. It is not critical to memorize each individual step along this pathway, but it is helpful to understand the steps of heme synthesis as this relates to the pathophysiology of porphyria. Again, largely this pathway is regulated at the level of ALAS1 transcription by the heme molecule. There's an additional isoform, ALS2, which is important in the bone marrow but is not known to be involved in disease in humans or pathogenic mutations. It's important to remember this as the feedback pathways and the other regulatory steps in heme synthesis at the rate-limiting step of the process shown on the last slide form the basis of treatment and prevention of porphyria. We can further describe porphyria by clinical manifestations, which include either neurologic symptoms or cutaneous lesions and skin pain. Overlap is often seen in several other porphyrias as patients can present with both neurologic and cutaneous manifestations of their disease. This table shows the porphyrias divided by subtypes defined by clinical presentation as well as enzymatic defects. Acute intermittent porphyria, delta ALA dehydratase porphyria, which is a very rare form of porphyria, represents the subtypes where only neurologic symptoms are seen. In hereditary coporphyria and variegate porphyria, overlap at the level of neurologic and cutaneous lesions is noted, and the remainder of porphyrias occur only with cutaneous symptoms. Symptoms from the acute porphyrias usually occur as sudden attacks related to a variety of underlying factors. These can be life-threatening, and a high degree of suspicion is required to diagnose acute porphyria in a timely fashion. The disease is generally more severe in women, and neurologic attacks occur rarely in childhood. Acute porphyria is generally manifest as neurovisceral symptoms and autonomic sequelae, which we'll outline in the next few slides. This table lists the common spectrum of symptoms seen in an acute porphyric attack with reference to the neurologic symptoms. Many or most attacks consist of a neurovisceral crisis where neurologic symptoms are accompanied by other signs and symptoms, including abdominal pain, constipation, vomiting, and often autonomic signs like fever and hypertensive urgency. While these are not specific to porphyria, porphyria should be considered on the differential diagnosis when unexplained neurologic changes occur in an otherwise healthy person in conjunction with other autonomic symptoms or hyponatremia. Cutaneous porphyrias generally consist of skin lesions, usually with skin blistering, peeling, erythema, and pain. Porphyria cutanea tarda can be acquired in liver diseases such as hepatitis C, and other cutaneous porphyrias generally manifest mostly in childhood. These three pictures illustrate the blistering, photosensitive, and other cutaneous lesions of the cutaneous porphyrias. Diagnosis of acute attacks is generally made by documenting elevated blood or urine levels of PBG. As the first step in heme synthesis, or ALA dehydrogenase porphyria, is extremely rare, PBG is virtually elevated in all porphyric attacks. Spot urine tests are offered at many centers, and confirmatory testing with 24-hour urine and stool collections are often carried out after this. Treatment should not be held in the case of high clinical suspicion, however, given the morbidity and mortality associated with acute porphyric attacks. More recently, genetic testing has become available for all porphyria subtypes and can identify germline mutations in affected individuals. For diagnosis of cutaneous porphyria, generally 24-hour urine and stool studies are needed to correlate elevated levels of individual porphyria metabolites with clinical phenotypes. Treatment of acute neurovisceral attacks includes hematin, which is essentially a preparation of heme, which thus blocks ALAS1 production of ALA, and consequently PBG. This then shuts down the heme synthesis pathway, which causes porphyria. This is often given with relatively high-dose glucose infusions, which further provides feedback and shuts down the involved pathways through feedback mechanisms. Treatment of cutaneous symptoms largely consists of avoidance of UV light and other supportive therapies. In summary, the porphyrias are comprised of 8 individual diseases caused by disorders in heme synthesis. Usually these are caused by mutations in the enzymes needed to metabolize ALA and PBG into heme, resulting in the buildup of various intermediate metabolites which have a variety of physiologic effects. Diagnosis is made through documentation of these metabolites, and treatment can involve hematin and other supportive measures and avoidance of provocation of attacks. These are several key references and reviews that may be helpful for further learning about porphyrias. I'd like to thank Dr. Thomas Ortel and Dr. Carlos De Castro of Duke University Medical Center for help with this talk. Thank you.